call the meeting to order. Welcome, everyone. This meeting of the Reading Municipal Light Department, RMLD, Board of Commissioners is being videotaped at the RMLD's office at 230 Ash Street, Reading, Mass. For distribution to the community television stations in Reading, North Reading, Wilmington, and Linfield. The RMLD Board of Commissioners recognizes the importance of hearing public comment at the discretion of the chair on items on the official agenda, as well as items not on the official agenda. We ask that all questions or comments from the public be directed to the chair, and that all parties, including members of the RMLD board, act in a professional and courteous manner when addressing the board or responding to comments. Once recognized by the chair, all persons addressing the board shall state their name, address prior to speaking. It's the role of the chair to maintain order in all public comment or ensuing discussions. Okay, we have some guests here today. We have George Hooper from the Citizens Advisory Board. Welcome, George.
Yeah, thank you.
And Tom O'Rourke as secretary tonight.
Yes.
All right.
Glad to do it.
And we have one guest in the audience here as well.
Bill Seldon.
Hey, Bill. How are you? Any public comment?
You might just comment about where Colleen is not here and Hamid is.
Oh, thank you for mentioning that. Yes, we have also Hamid filling in as general manager, acting GM is the term, acting GM. Thanks, Hamid. And you'll also be CFO and VP of engineering and all the, yeah, got it all. Okay, do we have any comment from the advisory board, George? Anything that, I don't know if you guys have met since.
Yeah, we had our update last week, actually.
Oh.
You guys, we met over school break, and
we bumped it, yeah.
You bumped it.
Yeah.
So.
Good. Any special issues or anything you want to comment on?
We did a few reviews, and Mead gave a presentation, so that was pretty well.
Okay. All right. Any other public comment? Doesn't look like it. All right. Well, this is an exciting time. We're going to reorganize the RMLD Board of Commissioners. So we have also Audit Committee and the General Manager Review Committee. Three members and two members for the Audit Committee. But why don't we start with the Vice Chair? I'd like to make a nomination of John Stempek stepping up to Vice Chair of the second by Tom O'Rourke.
Yeah,
and discussion? All those in favor? Record show. Oh, you can't vote for yourself?
You can vote for yourself.
You can.
Okay,
of course. 500. Congratulations, John.
Thank you.
And I'd also like to make another motion at Dave Talbot take over as chair.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor? Let the record show. It's 500. Let me, Dave, do you want to move here or should I slide this?
We can stay where we're.
All right, why don't I slide this? We'll do it this way.
Okay.
And then we'll do this.
The gavel.
This is the gavel.
Thank you very much.
And then you get this special sheet, too.
Okay.
That has all the words on it.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
All right.
Big words and little words.
So right, we have to do the committees now.
Okay. Thanks very
Congratulations.
Much.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Can you run that? What committees are there again?
What committees are there?
Audit committee with two members and the GM review committee with three members.
I just had a question just to include all potential committees. So I'm just wondering if we have any thoughts about the policy committee. I think we made a change, so we do the policies here.
Here, right.
I guess I had sort of mixed feelings about it. To the extent that there are minimal changes in policies, I think it's a good idea. Policies are due for some significant rewrites. I think it's not an appropriate use of the time here. So,
you're suggesting the formation of a policy committee?
You know, we always had a policy committee, then we rolled it in, which I think, frankly, I'd be curious how others feel. My experience was sometimes it was good, but we did have a lot of policies to review, and I'm not sure. Either they get done once over lightly, or we do them well, and it takes an hour inside the meeting. You know what I mean? That's my view. So that's just my view. So I guess I don't know what
I'm
I
not
just don't think this is a this forum of the is more to making decisions than it is to do debating.
Right.
I mean, we all know how it works at town meeting. You know, it's very laborious work reviewing policies. So.
Yeah, I think obviously there are different levels of policies, right, in terms of what are more important, what are less important. And I think it's been working pretty well with Colleen pretty much taking over the supervision of that and trying to get the major ones kind of done so that 80 to 90% of the work and thought process is already laid out before they're brought to us, as opposed to us spending innumerable hours discussing, going back and forth, and quite frankly, not having the sort of one-on-one personal relationship with the rest of the department to understand the intricacies of that. So I like the way it's been being handled so far. I think it's been doing a good job.
Meaning,
Dave?
No need.
Oh,
okay. Meaning no need for a separate committee. Yeah, yeah.
Correct.
I see what Tom's saying. We had that one meeting where it did seem like we spent an hour. But in general, it seemed like it streamlines things because we're all here, and it saves a extra meeting for all of us as well.
Right.
So
that was the intention, I think.
Yeah, I do prefer the way it is. I don't know. Others have comments.
Hamid, do you have any view on this as the sort of the GM stand-in?
That's great. It's been working. I know it's working for us. Might as well work on it.
And it's not like our agendas are so full and our meetings are so long that we can't handle dealing with it here. So sounds like we're all, unless Phil disagrees.
George, any opinion?
It's worked fine
the way it's gone.
Okay.
So
should we get a formal CAB recommendation on not forming another committee?
Yeah, it works for you guys.
With that, then I think we will not form an additional committee. But we still have the audit committee to fill and the GM review committee. So who would...
I think it makes sense to have, as we have in past years, to have Phil on the audit committee because he's the only CPA on the board here. So that's, and he's done it many, many times, so he knows all the.
I'm also on the board's appointee to the Town of Reading audit committee, too. I think it's best to stay that way.
Agreed.
Because I seem to have, when I go to those meetings, I seem to have all the knowledge as to how those meetings are supposed to run. So,
and it's 33 years of institutional knowledge as well.
Starting my 33rd year.
Yeah.
I do think Tom would be a good addition to the audit committee for something different and change, if that's okay.
Sure.
Yep.
Do we need a motion to that effect?
I think you could just appoint us.
Okay, I hereby appoint Phil Pacino and Tom O'Rourke as members of the audit committee.
Okay.
Right. And also as...
Your first act as chair.
And also as Phil Pacino as a member of the Town of Reading audit committee.
And Phil Pacino as a member of the Town of Reading audit committee.
Right.
So does that mean we have to vote on that? Anybody?
Yep.
No? You said you don't have to vote on it, right?
No. No, the chair can just appoint us.
Chair can appoint us. Yeah.
So we just need in the minutes to take his chair on that.
And then the GM review committee, so that leaves, I mean, should we have it be the other three be on that committee then?
Yeah, that's fine with me.
So John, Dave, and me?
Yeah, I'd be happy to do that.
Me too.
Yeah.
Okay, it is so.
Okay.
And I'm wondering, and maybe this isn't the meeting to do it, whether we should have some kind of committee to look at how we improve our renewable numbers or help facilitate, you know, the renewable installation by customers or institutions in our communities. So I don't know what that would look like or what the technicalities of forming such an advisory group would be, but I just sort of wanted to raise that and kind of get the sense of the board of whether this would be something, just hearing a lot in town and in the other towns about the desire to do this, but it's complex and how do we, you know, that maybe we can do more.
Mm-hmm.
So as a high concept, would anybody have thoughts on that?
I think it would be a good idea to have a citizens committee of some sort that we could participate in and they could participate in to help explore the alternatives for the Town of Reading and actually all of our towns including solar in their solution set.
Dave, are you thinking more than the Citizens Advisory Board? You think of actual citizens of the four towns?
Then if we could find people who are experts in the industry and have, you know, want to kind of help do some of the legwork to help figure out how to do this and advise us as a board of what our policies and rates should be, in addition to the expertise we get already from you know, which is considerable from staff, because that's what that's one of our two jobs is to set rates, right? Is to set that. So maybe we could think a little bit more and maybe have something on the next agenda that would formalize.
Right.
I don't know what the what it exactly looks like or.
Yeah, if we could update Colleen, because
yes.
I'm sure she has some
exactly.
thoughts around that. So she
yeah,
can come into the meeting.
I would not want to just sort of spring it on Hamid and on all of you without it being on the agenda. Okay. Yep.
Right.
So there's a study
okay. Okay. Exactly. And but we're also like very far from having that be an issue at this point.
Yeah, that's right. No, you're
so maybe a piece of this could be just to
right.
think about what you're saying is that whatever policies or actions we take would be up to the point or short of the point where it actually causes a
exactly.
problem from an engineering standpoint. Okay. Okay. Okay.
Chair, just a quick thought, not for discussion tonight necessarily, but I think it would be useful to decide whether, whatever constitution the committee is, but we do have, many of you know, a town meeting. Vanessa gave an update on the status of the town payment, but, you know, as months roll along so quickly, just so we have some visibility of that, you know, as a board. So
yep.
I don't know what, whether that's a couple of the board members here, you know, just keeping eyes on that. And
with the payment
up.
Question.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, just because, I mean, I think there's some actions that are going to be needed. We, you know, data's being collected. I know Colleen's done a lot of work, but just something so we, you know, we don't get here 6 months from now and kind of
yeah, well, thanks.
Where the time went.
I agree with you, and I think we should be moving forward with figuring that out sooner than later.
Right.
I mean, we already spent close to, 2 years discussing it,
yep.
and there was a lot of expertise and input, and okay, we did this two-year decision, but there's no, you know, it's already been a few months since that,
yep.
so maybe we can get this worked out in the next year,
mm-hmm.
even.
Mm-hmm.
So, anybody,
sure.
Is there a suggestion for...
Yeah, well, I guess my only suggestion would be, I think, nothing happens without, you know, because if we all own it, nobody's really driving it. So I think it needs someone or two people who are charged with the task of making sure we, because we only meet once a month, so that it gets up, you know, maybe there's a status report on it, and then that presumes that there's a couple of people who may be working with Colleen. So maybe because Colleen isn't here and
yep.
I've just raised it, maybe it's a good agenda item for the next board meeting just to say what is the process we want to use. Do we want to, we had a committee that met and were charged with certain responsibilities. Maybe it's something similar to that, or it's just the RMLD subset of the board, but just something so that, you know, someone's work is, even Colleen, I mean, she gets caught up in a million
exactly.
things. So we'll be,
you
know, certainly be here.
One approach might be, if I may, might be to have Colleen just report on it on a regular basis at every month of our meeting. In terms of what progress is being made or is not being made on coming to some kind of a conclusion about, you know, the consultant or coming up with the algorithm or whatever it may be. And I think she is thinking about that and whatnot. It just takes sort of time.
Yep.
It also takes history
yep.
of what's happening in our system, right,
exactly.
in terms of the investment that we're making, which is the key thing
yeah.
about rebuilding our infrastructure. And that's being a major item. So, and Colleen is perhaps, and Hamida are the closest to this. So perhaps having just a short report on that, and then maybe we could, if need be, we could delve into it more in a more needed fashion.
Yeah, I guess what I was thinking is, I think that's a good idea. But it seems to me that in between meetings or whatever, there's probably some data analysis and things that need to happen that you don't necessarily want to do here, but could be done. So as part
mm-hmm.
of the report out, you know, it would be a solely Colleen's responsibility, because I'm guessing there could be more than one model that comes out of some of the analysis,
mm-hmm.
that kind of thing. So
right.
Solar and batteries.
supposed to be another one? Mic for Hamid?
We're down a microphone.
So can,
oh, we are.
Can people hear what Hamid is saying?
Well, or over there. Either that or share Tom's, whichever, you know.
Yeah.
Okay, good.
He doesn't want to share what you're talking.
Well,
he doesn't know what's on your microphone.
He's the only one that's going to be speaking, so he wants to sit there.
Yeah, like what I said, Chuck and Bill, the IRD department, they're working on a roadmap, you know, as to the renewables and also the solar and battery storage and all of that. You know, we made a roadmap when Jane was over here, that, you know, how we see RMLD, where we see RMLD in 5 years, 10 years from now. But now we're due for another study and see that, you know, with all the changes that they come in about and limitations, where are we going to go with that? And I guess this would be good.
Right. I think what Tom's concerned about is that from our last meeting, right, we saw that continuing decrease in,
yeah,
kilowatt hour sales, right?
Right.
And that sort of was the whole basis for why we did this in the first,
right,
place. So it's one thing to track it historically, but another to address what are you going to,
yeah,
do about it,
yeah,
and what is that end result in,
yeah,
terms of contribution to the town or the towns and,
right,
yeah, whatnot.
And I guess a final thought, in it, you know, because I think the report out is key,
right,
but someone needs to kind of put a timeline together,
yep,
because,
mm-hmm,
otherwise the timeline is infinite, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
well, it's got a hard stop at the end of 2 years, so
right, yeah,
we do
know that.
Yeah.
Right, but we don't want it to be like final exam in college.
Right.
You open the book up, you take the shrink wrap off in May. So, you know, just so that's sort of the activities I would see happening.
Sure.
You know, okay,
right,
we start with the end in mind. Here's what we need to have. We need to involve the town. We need to present. We need to do this.
Yep.
We need the data. We need to analyze it. You know, that kind of stuff.
So I would suggest we table it for now until,
yeah,
Colleen is back,
right,
and make it an item for the next board meeting,
yeah,
to have Colleen comment on it,
yeah,
in terms of what progress is being made.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The other
thing, Mr. Chairman, is I believe in the next year or two, the 20-year agreement comes up for renewal among all the towns.
Next year.
It's,
yeah,
next year, so I think I'd like to see that go on the agenda for our next meeting,
yeah,
also.
I agree with you. Thank,
right,
you for that
update
reminder.
Where,
good point.
That,
and,
yep,
you know, that's really, that wraps up, too, with the payment issue. And shouldn't those things be considered, you know, as a piece? I mean, they're kind of interrelated.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Exactly.
So.
Exactly. So.
George, not to put you on the spot, but what do you think about all this? as our most valued customer being Wilmington.
It's funny you brought up, we were to the,
yes,
town manager, and he had asked me, he goes, isn't the 20-year agreement coming up,
yeah,
or didn't we do with the X? And I said, yeah, it's next year.
Okay.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. I mean, we'd love Wilmington's, in particular, Wilmington's input at any time on that and your involvement, and we'd love to get this done this year.
Right.
And
so
I'm sure we'll have plenty to say as,
yes,
the stats come out. So.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Okay. Yeah.
As,
okay,
a part of that plan, also they're working on the electrification, you know, that, you know, EV chargers and,
right,
you know, how to promote this, you know, electric sales. So this is something that IRD is working on it.
Right.
And actually we have a project right now that this is on the list of things.
Is
that,
not to put Bill on the spot, but if you want to talk a little bit about that and take some airtime to, or next time, if you're not wanting to do that.
Yeah.
Okay, that'd be great.
Okay.
And since I'm thinking of it, you know, we have a survey on the RMLD website asking businesses to talk about your plans for electric car charging stations. And, you know, we certainly would like to do everything possible to promote and help businesses get those installed. It's good for a lot of reasons, but one of them is, you know, it promotes electric car use and it promotes electricity sales. That's the most sort of craven, you know, selfish reason, but there's lots of,
mm-hmm,
other good reasons, which are that they're better for the environment. So, I'm sorry, I mean, you were in the middle of...
Yeah, that's it. I was just going to say that, you know, we have that study going on, too,
okay,
for electrification. And
so
what we're going to do with the EV chargers,
yep,
and, you know, that promoting the sales, basically.
So we've raised a lot of things, and maybe we should have a meeting sort of early in May, and maybe we need two meetings before we really get into the summer season to kind of really get some of these things underway and thought through.
Like early May, early June.
Yeah, maybe
like
we
that.
Need two meetings in May just to kind of, we've talked about a lot of big things here.
We'll schedule it.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we can talk about that at the end of the meeting.
Okay.
And also want to acknowledge that Karen came in late, but Karen Herrick from FinCom is here. Thank you for thank you for coming. Okay. So, George, you have a report from. Are you all?
Approval of board minutes.
Sorry, approval of board minutes.
Move that the board and commissioners approve the meeting minutes of February 13, 2019, on the recommendation of the general manager.
Second.
All in favor?
Discussion.
Discussion. Yeah. Anybody want to discuss the motion?
No.
No. Okay. All in favor? Motion passed 5-0. And George, would you like to report on the CAB meeting of April 18th?
Yeah, usually this is one of the commissioners that gives us up, and I don't think we had anybody there.
Okay.
I was slated, but I couldn't make it. Some changes.
Which is fine. Yeah, no, I.
Tax season ended on Wednesday. I was pretty burned out.
I'm sure you were.
Yeah.
Again, Hamid had given his presentation, and Chuck has done a fine job. I have noticed that, although. The presentation you guys get is much more colorful and much better than the ones we get.
Oh, wow. We can change that. That's easy to do.
We have to take a comparison.
We know we need to simplify it for when it goes.
Let's make that.
We just talked about it. You know, same stuff, same material.
Well, they probably know you like a quick pace to your meetings.
Yeah.
Yes, we do. That's right, too. We get it done. But. No, I think you guys are going to get that same presentation tonight,
yes,
correct?
Yes, exactly, yes.
Bill's going to do it, and not Chuck this time. And
And then I'm going to do mine.
Okay. So we will accept that as your report from the
That'll
academy.
That'll be my official report.
Okay. So, Bill, I guess you're up. Thanks.
We can share.
He won't share with you, Tom, but he's going to share with Bill, that microphone.
So Bill Sheldon,
I just wanted to note that.
Heads up RMLD's Integrated Resources Division, and you're on, Bill.
Hi, thank you. Good evening. I don't know if I can be as colorful as Chuck with these presentations. He did leave me with some good info. I was going, actually reviewing this particular slide, which shows you the total expenses, purchase power expenses, compared at the actuals compared to the budget. I believe when he presented this information to you for January, he just had it in a stacked bar type graph. Now we've changed a little bit and given you the 12 months of budgeted info. That line, top line right there, actually represents a total of approximately $68 million worth of purchase power budget. The actuals down here, with this line right here with the combined January and February, and this is the differential. What I did notice, and I apologize, that this, we need to kind of adjust some of these figures, because when I was looking at it, I was looking at the budget versus actual, and if you look at the other slides, and it'll become more apparent when we review the other slides, the budgeted line does not take into account the deferred fuel account, which is actually accounted for in our actual numbers. So these numbers are either, depending on how you want to look at it, overstated or understated, depending on whether you're looking at the actuals or the budgeted. So I don't know how you guys want to view that in the future. I like to look at it as, if I take out the deferred fuel account, we're a lot closer to the budget number that the budget figures show. But we should really defer to Wendy on how we represent those numbers going forward. Maybe it's just include that deferred fuel number in with the budgeted number. But in any case, the overall number is a lot closer to budget. It's about $300,000 over budget when you take that into consideration. And then if you go, that again becomes a lot more apparent when you go to the energy costs and compare actuals to the budgeted number. We're about $250,000 now over what we had budgeted for energy the big difference, because in January that number was over $500,000 over budget. Fuel prices, specifically natural gas, have come down significantly. So that's helping to lower that gap between what we budgeted and the actual numbers going in. Moving into capacity, we're pretty much right on what we had budgeted. It's roughly, it's going to come in at about $2 million through May, and then it decreases to about $1.7 million per month for the rest of the year. That's what we think we're going to see. So those numbers look good. No surprises there. And the transmission costs also, now that we're into February, seem to be in line with where we figured they would be. Those are going to jump up and down a little bit depending on weather, since our transmission costs are weather dependent. So what we forecast could be a little bit off depending on whether we have a warmer than average summer or when we get into the later months, a cooler winter. So are there any questions on those numbers?
No.
And then the last slide just compares where the actual kilowatt hours that we purchased for the month are coming from by the resource. The only real, the real numbers to comment are on would be these, the ISO market, spot market numbers are again net selling into the market.
Yep.
About 2 million kilowatt hours, I believe, went back into the market in February out of our portfolio. That's pretty much all I have to say, unless there's questions.
I do. As you break down the percentages here, what's the nuclear percentage here? Is it about 10, 15%?
Yeah, a little less than that, but right, it's in that area, yes.
And the renewable piece, non-nuclear renewable?
Which includes our wind, all of our hydro. I think we were pretty much close to almost 15%, right around there. So if you add nuclear and non-nuclear renewables, we're getting up there.
And that number comes from, where does that number come from? The 15%.
Power supply charts that I look at in the back room.
Okay. Anybody have questions?
No.
No.
Nope.
And as far as where we are with our program for electrification, I'm not going to steal Chuck's thunder.
Yep.
But we did have a meeting today with Volta. They came in and educated us a little bit about how we can take advantage of their, not just us, but our territory, how we could take advantage of using their approach to introducing charging stations
mm-hmm.
to our commercial customers pretty much at no cost.
I'm sorry, Volta?
Yes, Volta is really, they've been in this area for about 6 months now, but they've been in California and
what are they? Just step back to explain what that is.
They are basically a marketer of an integration between advertising and charging stations.
Yep.
And their specialty is areas like strip malls, any area where you're going to get a lot of turnover of cars, but they see a value in this whole electric vehicle
yep.
market. It fits in well with their business approach. Their business approach actually seems to be pretty sustainable, and it would fit in well with our supermarkets, maybe an area like the Home Depot and Jordan's, that type of an area.
How does that relate to ChargePoint, which I know is the brand of a lot of chargers?
Voltar actually owns their own charging stations. So what they would basically do is make an arrangement with either the property owner itself, or if they can't do that directly with the utility, where they put the infrastructure, and they just would either become another account of ours, where we would send them the bill.
Yep.
They would pay the electricity bill, and then they offset that cost and make their profit off of the advertising that they have on.
I see.
On their specific unit. That doesn't solve all of the charging station needs, obviously, but it does help in that particular market, and that leaves us to explore other avenues where we just brought a consultant on board to help us work on a plan for the electric vehicle program that we want to offer. Chuck's vision is to attempt as best as we can to, as we add those kilowatt hours, add them with carbon neutral kilowatt hours.
Uh-huh.
So that's kind of like our goal, is to figure out how we're going to do that.
Okay. Good.
Okay, that's a good question.
Please. Phil, so it's zero cost. They do the whole thing.
Right.
It doesn't cost the retailer or MLD anything to put in the charging station.
It shouldn't, as long as there's not a lot of build-out. If it was in a specific area where you had to do a lot of trenching or whatever to get to the site, that we'd have to figure out how to share those costs. The majority of the places that they go into, though, I'm not sure of the exact percentage, but the majority of them just get connected directly to the panel of whatever business you're connecting them up to.
And their model is advertising? They have advertising on their kiosk?
Yes, okay. Right. And it's a pretty slick unit. If you look at their charging station, it has basically no sound, just panels on either side that scroll every 8 seconds.
Okay.
So they hold on to one of those 8-second panels for working with nonprofits. They could work with us. We could maybe have some information about programs that the light department offers. That would work in well with getting our messages out. And then the rest of those panels are sold off as advertising, usually with advertising for the tenants that are actually in the building. So if it was Market Basket, it could be their weekly specials could be on one 8-second panel, and then they go on to other things, like whether or not it was
Stop and Shop.
Stop and Shop. they're keenly interested in areas like that. They're also working nationwide with companies like Walmart's and other large chains, Whole Foods. They have accounts with.
Does the company get a percentage of something where the location is? So if Stop and Shop puts one down there, does Stop and Shop get a percentage of something?
They get a lease, and they get that, and they get the advertising.
Okay.
Oh, they get a lease payment for the parking space?
They get a lease payment for the parking spaces that are out there. They get the advertising, and the big kicker is that Volta says, and we'll pay for the electricity. And the customer that pulls up to the thing is getting a free charge.
Oh, they get it for free?
Yep.
Wow.
Hard to believe it's sustainable, isn't it?
Yeah, it really is, just for some ads for 8 seconds.
But ads are expensive.
I guess so.
It does sound too good to be true, in a way.
It does sound, yeah.
They actually, I think they have 1,000 units nationwide now already. So.
That's nothing.
I mean, I don't know.
Right? 1,000 across the country.
I don't know.
Anyway.
They're proving out their business model, obviously, with that. So.
Well, it's all very promising, and thanks for your efforts. Is there, That was your, is that the conclude your report or?
Yeah. Yeah, and I'm sure Chuck will have a lot more to say when he gets back in here, depending on the direction of where you guys want to go with it.
Yeah.
But
good. That's great.
Great, okay.
Good, thank you.
Okay.
Right, now we have an action item here. Is that, okay.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah. Thank you, Bill.
Yeah. Well, thanks, Bill.
Yep.
Record.
I guess, are we going to go for the Energy New England?
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a motion for Energy
New
England.
Yeah, I'll do it. You want to break?
No, no.
Okay, go ahead.
I just have a question. You got here listed Board of Directors or Commissioners. Which one? Is it one or the other? In the motion that I have here in front of me. Unless the motion's changed in the agenda. Well, aren't we're a Board of Commissioners.
It's probably language.
Why don't we change it to?
Yep,
yeah,
it should be Board of Commissioners.
Right.
It's probably stock language that
Ian
E. sent over, and yeah.
So, move that pursuant to section 3.2 of the operating agreement of the Energy New England LLC, the Reading Municipal Light Department Board of Commissioners hereby appoint Colleen O'Brien as a Class B Director of the Energy New England LLC Board of Directors for a term of 3 years as recommended by the General Manager.
Seconds.
Discussion? Or Hamid, is there anything to explain?
No, this is basically Colleen is going to be on the board.
Yep.
And, that's very, very, we are looking forward to
yep.
that.
Yep.
Good. Good.
So that's what a Class B yes. member is, it's voting?
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
That's good.
Good.
Excellent.
Discussion?
Excellent.
No?
Yep.
No? All in favor? All opposed? 0-5-0 is the vote in favor. Thank you, Hamid.
Thank you so much.
And now you're back up as the engineering and operations report.
So I'm covering for him now. Okay. The first slide talking about the underway. We recently completed construction, major construction projects. We got three projects that there. One is expected to be completed by 2019. That's the first one for W5, for W12 getaway improvements at Station 4. Station 4 also, we moving one of the two of the getaways. We upgrade two of the getaways, 4W6 and 4W16. At Station 5, 525 Andover road upgrade in Wilmington, that is completed. The next slide, I'm glad to report that the battery storage project is moving, and you know we have made substantial progress on that. You see in the pictures over here that you know these are all battery units that they installed. The project is going to be completed somewhere between mid-May to end of May, but we should be able to use that as of June 1st, which is really good. We're looking forward to that.
I like the pictures, by the way. They really help.
They really help.
That's what I started to do. That figure that you know, give you some
very nice.
Sense of you know exactly what's going on, since not everybody's getting the opportunity to go to the site and see that. So we've got to build that. Yeah.
Before you move on from that, Hamid, I mean, for the one or three or four people who might be actually watching the meeting, or this is a huge deal, this battery.
Yes.
So I think it's worth stopping to kind of explain to those who might be tuning in what this battery is all about and why it's such a big deal. And I believe it's the biggest in the state. I could be wrong about
that. It's the largest project in the state.
What is it?
You got it. Basically, what it does, it stores the energy during the light load period.
Yep.
And then it's going to release the energy when you know it's the peak.
Yep.
Basically, it's being dispatched by NextEra. They monitor the market and see that you know how what the trend of the load is, and basically you are the peak shaving method. Basically.
And what is the capacity of this battery?
The capacity of this one is 5 megawatts.
Hours, you know, right?
They're powered, right.
5 megawatt hours.
5 megawatt hours,
yeah.
Right. And then what it does, it's going to shave the peak during the, like what I said, during the high usage period, which is going to save us the capacity and transmission charges that, you know, it's saving for the ratepayers.
Yep.
So during the high usage period, we don't pay those big charges to the New England ISO. We also have the 2.5 megawatts of generation gas turbine.
Next to that.
Which next to that.
Yep.
It's sitting right next to that, actually. And that is also going to be used during the system peak peak shaver.
Yeah.
And that helps also. Every bit helps. You know,
yep.
These are the projects which really we are looking forward and because it's saving money for everybody. You know, the capacity charges, the capacity is going down, but the transmission charges are going up.
Yep, which means the cost of bringing the electricity
exactly
into the zone.
Yeah, and these are the pass-through
right
to the customers.
Yeah.
So any savings like that, it would mean savings for the customers, basically.
And just remind us again the grant that RMLD was
yes
able to get.
We got a $1 million grant from the state, Governor Baker, that, you know, that was nice. That helps the project in order to...
So and that was also the biggest grant...
Yes, the biggest grant
that
RMLD
any light plan has gotten,
that's
I believe.
Right.
I mean, we might as well take the opportunity to do a little
horn
tooting
right
for the staff
that
really, you know, pulled it out for this one. You know, $1 million grant they won.
Yeah.
We just got our first
yeah
check this month.
Nice. Huh? Is it actually for $1 million?
No.
How much is it for? And the check has cleared.
Yes.
Okay, good. $330,000 from the Commonwealth.
Yeah,
it
right
has cleared. Okay, good work for Hamid, Colleen, Bill, everybody.
Thank you.
Getting this grant, getting the biggest battery, I believe, of any light plant in the state, and
right
so that's just wonderful, and it's a great asset for so many reasons. So thank you for that.
Yeah, the department is continuously looking for opportunities for grants
yeah
anywhere that, you know, we can get money and do projects like these.
Mm-hmm.
These are good for the environment as well as, you know, saving money for the ratepayers. So we're really looking, and IRD is doing a great job in, you know,
yeah, that's
searching for
huge
those opportunities.
And that's lithium-ion technology, right? It's the same as what's in electric cars, I believe.
That's right.
Yeah.
And eventually, actually, well now the next step is the electric chargers that, you know, well, the same thing. They charge during the light usage. And then they can release the power back on to, that's the next generation.
You're talking about using
charging
cars as grid
right
batteries. Yeah, that's a while off, but yeah.
To release the charge,
yep,
you know, to the network during the peak period.
And by the way, I assume that when, now I'm getting a little off topic here, but when we do have lots of electric cars charging, that you'll, during these peak times, you're going to have a way to shut off those chargers so that we're not causing a peak by 200 cars charging at 2 p.m. on a
you
July.
You can program those. Yeah. They're getting more and more sophisticated.
Yeah.
So we can program them so for certain hours they are on, certain hours they are off. And also if somebody, you know, is parking the car all day long, you know, they're going to get, you know, after they're fully charged.
Yep.
If they don't move the car, you know, you can get the ticket for that. Or you're
we'll
going
to send somebody
like
out
$2
to
or
to key
money
the car.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
So or even, you know, they could send a message to the, you know,
yep,
to the owner that, you know, hey, listen, the car is charged up, it's time to move, or you're going to be paying $2 an hour if you're willing to, you know, pay.
Yep.
And keep the car. But it's really exciting. We're looking for those.
Yep.
You know,
can I ask one question? Hamid, where is this battery?
Oh, this battery is at station 3.
Okay.
You see where
North
the next to the generator. The
it says it right there. Yes. Yes.
It's
North
right
ready
next to it.
Right.
It's sitting right, exactly right
yeah
next to it. So
thank you.
We also took the same this opportunity
yeah
also
yeah
to run some pipes and going all the way to the station, so
damn
we can move some of those underground feeders, move them up, take them out of the duct bank to increase the
mm-hmm
ratings, because
mm
there was a problem,
yep,
design problem there to begin with when this substation was designed.
Mm-hmm.
So now we are correcting it. You know, this was opportunity to use the same trench as the trenching. So
just to digress, getting that property proved to be quite a bonanza.
Yeah, it was. Oh,
yeah.
You know,
yeah,
quite a bonanza getting the ability to get that property.
Yeah,
I know that's a couple. It's at least two or three administrations ago, but it's been quite a bonanza at this point to get that piece of property up there.
Perfect location. Right,
yep.
For
yeah
the substation as well as, you know, the
mm-hmm
generators. I got another good news for you. The generator, if you recall, you know, we had problems, and I gave that report to the CAB members, CAB board last time. During the hot summer days, we had to leave the doors open for ventilation because, you know, it was heat was derating the engine's output. And now we were informed by the manufacturer, because after consulting, going back and forth, apparently Stirling had the same problem too, and they ended up relocating the sensor, the heat sensor,
oh,
from, believe it or not, from the engine side to the, which is very, you know, a very simple concept. They're moving it now to the other end of the room, which is closer to the air intake. So that way it's going to solve the problem, so we don't have to, you know, do any modifications to the chamber or to the housing.
Hmm.
So that's being done by end of the month. So it should be ready for full rating, because the generator was putting out like, you know, 2 point, the sensor, when it senses the heat, it wouldn't let it go all the way to 2.5 megawatts. So it would go like 2.3 megawatts. So now we're going to have to, we can push it all the way up to 2.5 megawatts.
I'm whispering to Tom because he's on the I'm digressing again, the YMCA board. Can we hook up all of the electric the bicycles to charge
that,
the battery? I mean, just get these things all.
Those green bikes are on the road now, and yep. I'm surprised that nobody has come up with, you know, the idea of maybe putting a battery and charging up the battery
while
they're pedaling, you
exactly.
know, and then release that.
Right.
You know?
We can
I'm
actually
sure
maybe hook
up
a bike
up
here
idea.
And get commissioners ready.
Exactly.
During the,
yeah.
We could
during
be
the meeting. Exercising during the
yeah.
meeting.
Right, right.
Anyway.
That would be good for you, Dave. You
talking about it.
Summertime.
What are you implying?
You can help us, you know, to the environmental.
Okay, let's move on. Let's
all
move
right,
on.
Thank you.
Good.
Well,
you're welcome.
Enough joking.
Okay,
we need to be serious at these meetings.
The next, any other questions? I'm sorry. So the next one is the area upgrade that is currently underway. We finished it. These step-down upgrades, these are the areas that they're very old, and as we go through these, we got like about 60 of them, and we're making good progress on those. We go through these old communities and removing the step-downs, converting the voltage from 5 kV to 13.2, which means lower losses, and that's another saving for us. And we clean up all the poles, and if we need to replace the poles, we replace them. Clean up the secondaries, overhead primaries, transformers, upgrading the areas, which is actually three or four projects combined into one. This is what basically the step-down upgrade entails. So we finished one of these big projects. This was a big, huge area that we got cleaned up, McDonald Road in Wilmington. So. We got many of them. Most of those are in Wilmington. We got some in North Reading and also Linfield.
I like the way you have the gloomy, dark, gray picture
right.
as the before, and then the bright blue. And
right. Yeah,
just really good marketing.
Turned it into a sunny day.
Yeah. So that takes care of some of those open wires too. That, you know, it's given us hard time during the storms and here. So we cleaning up those. The next slide is giving you another maintenance, major maintenance upgrades that we are going through, and we got a program established. The program actually, it's a 15-year program, and as part of that, we are going through these aged underground areas, and you know we upgrade everything: transformers, the cables, wires, and you know the secondary services, and this is underground. So these are the areas that we're completed: the Moran Road in Linfield, Friendship Lane in Linfield, Ohio Street in Wilmington, and Gloria Lane in North Reading. This is the job that we used to do. That, you know, lots of time we used to do that only by contractors. Now still we use contractors, but our crews, they're all trained, and now they're. That's why it's speeding up. We used to do like one or two of these by contractors. Now we don't as many as you know. We go through, and these are the pictures before and after. You see on the left side, this is before. You can see that, you know, all of the transformers, basically they're gone. They're very aged. There are holes in them. They got the rusty. They're rusty. And on the right, it shows what the new transformers they look like. So we're going through those upgrades, which is great. The next slide is showing you basically the maintenance programs. They're all going very well. And the inspection programs, the infrared scan of the substations, and as well as the parks, we haven't had any problems, any issues, which is a good thing. The next slide is showing you the double poles in all four communities, and you see that, you know, these numbers, they're moving up and down. We are going through, we have dedicated crews that they go around and they do these transfers. You know, as we're going on in Linfield, we got 26 of them. Reading, we got 37. North Reading, 16, and Wilmington, 18. So that's what the latest update is on those. That means these are the areas that we replace the poles, and then we do the transfers, and the next one is it's going to go to Comcast and fire department, and finally, you know, we remove the poll bots. So the last slide, actually, this slide is the next slide. It's not the last. It's going to show you the reliability indices. The SAID, KD, and SAIFI, they're all well below the regional and national averages, which the reliability is very good. These are how we measure the reliability of the service to the town and to the communities. The next slide, the last slide actually, that shows the causes of outages for the past 5 years. And the annual average is the blue, and the red one is year to date. So far we've had only 2 more vehicle accidents. I hope that, you know, we have none. That would be the ideal thing, you know. But we're making progress with the tree trimming, and you know that those are going very well. And also the storm events that, you know, this is a report that they gave to the CAB. In the March we had 6 outages, 4 in Wilmington, 1 in Linfield, and 1 in Reading. And these are the ones that, you know, the duration was anywhere from 47 minutes to 2 hours in Wilmington, obviously. This is the one that tree came down and during the storm and made some damage. And we had animal contacts, underground failure. And the outages to date in April were 8 outages, 5 in Wilmington, 2 in Linfield, and 1 in Reading. We had 2 motor vehicle accidents, 4 tree incidents, and 1 weather issue. And this was the storm of the April 3rd that took, duration in some areas with as much as, you know, 4 hours. The ones that, you know, they got the lines and the poles, they came down, and the lines, they got heavily damaged. But all in all, you know, we were able to restore the services to the people in a timely manner.
Quick question.
Yes,
Hamid,
sir.
So am I reading this right, that our outages are like 10% of what they normally are this time of year? Am I reading the chart right?
Since January.
But these numbers for the average from 2014 to 18, those are year-to-date numbers as well?
No, those are the 5 years averages. The 5 years, the average of the 5 years. These
that's
are
the full year.
What
full
the
year.
Blue will for
that's
five
the
years.
Full year, and
that's
our
right.
numbers
the
are only
year-to-date.
The
red one. The red ones are the full year.
Okay.
So far, since from
so
the, you know, in 2019. It's
okay, so the blue, the other numbers are not, they're the full year.
They are,
so
they are the 5 year averages, the annual averages
annual
from
average.
2014 to 2018. You know, so there's some years they're high, some years they're low. We take the average and we compare ourselves for the 5 years.
So we're
average.
Way below
we're
average.
Way below, yes.
Because we should be about 1/3 of these or 1/4 of these numbers,
well,
and we're much less.
Not necessarily. That's not how it goes, because one storm could very well move and shift these numbers.
Yeah, okay.
But, you know, it's a way of measuring that, you know, well, our maintenance program is working and where we need to focus. Let's say, for instance, if I have too many wildlife, and right now if it was half, 50%, and we're only the first quarter of 2019, that tells me that, you know, well, we're going to have to beef up that program, the wildlife protection program.
Mm-hmm.
That's a measure for us to see that, you know, where we need to focus. Maybe, you know, I don't like to see these numbers moving up, but as they move up, we continuously assessing, you know, where might be the problems. And then we go back to the feeders and see which feeder has experienced these problems. And where the problem is. If it's open wire, then we have a project, and you know, we.
Yeah. I wonder if this chart might be better if you still do the 5 year average, but that 5 year average is also year to date. Do you know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah. Well, it.
So
yeah,
that when we're comparing it, we're comparing it more.
Apples to apples.
Apples
yeah,
to apples.
Yeah, sure. We could do that.
So both bars are year to date numbers.
We can bring it all the way
third,
to the.
Maybe
date.
Put a third bar in.
Yeah.
Maybe you even do a third bar.
Yeah.
So you have the total for the year. A year-to-date and based upon history, and a year-to-date based upon actual. For the
I
year.
Don't know if you need that at the third bar, because it's seasonal, you know?
Yeah. I could include the 2019 to date, too, so you could see that, you know, compared to that. That's kind of
today's point, I think, because you can't really extrapolate, so a year-to-date comparison makes sense.
See, I think the two bars would be plenty, and just the
yeah,
other bar
the
be
only problem is if you add 2019 year to date, because the numbers are low, actually those averages, they're coming down.
No, I wouldn't use just 1 year.
Yeah.
I would still use the 5 year average.
Right. And 5 year average, and then what we could do maybe if you wanted, we could show the year before, 2018, full year. So we can compare the full year of 2018
sure.
and then where we are with respect to, you know, 2019.
I think what
so
Dave, correct me if I'm wrong, Dave, I think what Dave was saying is what you would show for the blue, you would do a 5 year average for quarter one.
Correct.
Oh, okay.
That's
I
what
see.
I'm saying.
No,
and that's
I
all.
Know, I don't
oh,
know if
yeah,
you
sure.
have that
right.
data.
We have that data. We
yeah.
could do that. Yeah. For the quarter. That's fine.
Yeah.
We could change that. Yeah. We have the data.
That's what I was saying. Thank you, Tom.
Great.
Do you need any money, Amit?
What is it? I'm sorry?
Do you need any money tonight?
Oh, well, no tonight. You guys are off.
No transformers, huh?
No transformers. Next meeting, I'm going to have a few bids that, you know, we have to
okay.
get the approval. I appreciate
all right.
it.
Okay.
So that concludes my meeting, if my report, if you have any questions.
No, it's great.
No, it's good. Well, thank you, Amit.
Thank you, Amit.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So next
now
meeting,
we have
next
general
meeting?
Discussion, and we mentioned a few. Go ahead.
Yeah,
Tom.
No, I just wanted when it comes to next board meeting, I have
yep.
a board wide function committee on the 16th, so
oh, you
I
do?
Won't be available. So note that.
Okay.
Right. Sure.
We mentioned a bunch of things, important topics, payment, 20-year agreement, you know, a possible new committee. Wondering if we want to try to have three meetings between now and the end of two instead of two, between now and the end of June, have three. So, I just meant that. So maybe if we had one, and Tom can't do the 16th. What if we had one on the 9th, and then one at the end of May, and then one in June? 20th.
Sounds good to me.
Because then it'll get slow in the summer.
The 9th.
Yeah,
May 9th.
Let me just check that. See.
Check that too.
May 9th.
May 9th's good for me.
I can't do May 9th.
And are we stuck on Thursday nights? Does it always have to be a Thursday night?
No.
No.
8th.
How is 8th, John?
It's 8th is possible, certainly.
I cannot do the 8th.
Okay.
This is debatable for me at this
okay.
point, too.
Tuesday the 7th?
Yep, I can do that.
I'm available that night.
Okay, why don't we do it? I know it's coming right up, but...
Yep. Okay.
Let's do that, and then let's do... If
normal start time, right? 7:30?
Yeah, and then if we push the 16th one back, you know, maybe to the late in May, and then we'll just keep the June 20th one. So what would be good for late May for people?
Maybe.
So when's Memorial Day? So let's just use that as
yeah.
a... Is that the 27th?
Is that the 27th?
It is.
About
so
the
probably 23rd. The week before.
The Thursday, the 23rd work for people?
Yeah.
Yeah, so...
Yeah, that could work. Or
23rd?
Should we make it the first week of June instead? Not try to crowd it into that Memorial Day week.
So what do we decide on
for
the second meeting of May? What date?
We haven't decided.
I think Thursday the 23rd, maybe?
It's a... The 23rd is good for me. What
is it? Okay.
Okay with the 23rd.
Well, I'm just thinking it's kind of crowding that holiday week when we're all trying to get out Thursday or
Friday,
maybe
yeah.
a little early or whatever.
Okay.
What about the week after?
The holiday week is not that weekend, is it?
The 27th is Memorial Day, right?
Is it?
Yeah.
So what about the 29th?
Okay.
What about the 29th or the 30th?
Let's see.
Oh,
20.
I see.
Yeah.
Not available either the 29th or the 30th.
Yeah, those aren't good for me.
They're not good.
Okay,
I'd rather do the 23rd.
Fine. The 23rd works for everybody.
Okay.
I may not be here.
What?
Whoa.
Whoa. It brings to a stop.
Well, wait a minute. That is a key. I don't think we want to rely on any of us to take detailed.
Exactly.
If we're going to meet on the 7th, could we have a pre-agenda sent out and or... Any kind of pre-work that needs to be done so we can make it efficient?
Yeah. Good suggestion.
Yeah.
Good suggestion.
I'd like
we
to
will, g- for sure.
Okay, so someone needs to organize that.
Yes. I guess that's on me at this point.
Just reiterating everything that
okay.
you wanted to
Yes. Was June 6th bad for people? As for the second meeting?
Instead of the...
No, that's fine.
Is June 6th okay?
That address your concern about the budget?
Yeah, that works for me, the June 6th.
June 6th?
Or
do we have a June meeting as well?
We do have the 20th, so then that would be...
I guess it's about one way or the other. Yeah.
Let's do the earlier. I think you said the 23rd, right,
okay.
Dave?
The 23rd was the
okay.
one.
So we have the 7th, the 23rd, and then we could potentially, we could keep the 20th or we could move it up a week, but we could figure that out later. So the 7th and the 23rd, let's just do those. And we'll, if we have to move the 20th, we'll do it.
Okay. How does that impact our CAB meeting?
Well, we have that one on the 16th. So.
Oh, yeah, we were going and trying to go with the same day at the...
I'm available for that meeting.
Cap.
Yeah. I'm up for that meeting, so.
You are available?
I'm on the cap for the CAB meeting, yes.
Is this
What we could do is just go get through the summer and then switch back to doing it the same.
Yep.
Because we want to try to get a couple things done before the summer. Mm-hmm. And then we go back to our normal fall thing, switch back to have them the same night.
I agree. Yeah. So are you okay if we just leave the CAB meetings as they are and not mess with that?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
And the only other thing I would say maybe would be a good idea, not in these next couple meetings, but given all the discussion about the industrial zone and the potential reuse of this area, that it might be a good idea to have a meeting with the select board and just to kind of understand, you know, what we're all thinking could be happening to the zone, to bounce ideas off each other, and just sort of discuss the future of the site. Mm-hmm. Unless anybody disagrees.
I'd like to know what those proposals are.
I don't think there are any. Right. You know, nothing's hard and fast, so it's more.
Thing.
Yeah.
You know, or if there are, what are they? You know,
right.
What do we need to know about? What do we need to plan for?
Sure.
Understanding what some of the site improvements RMLD is already, you know, planning to do, and how that fits in with maybe future uses. You know, how does the DPW site relate to?
Right.
You know, those discussions relate to RMLD. I think it would just be benefit to have one meeting where both boards were in the same room and sort of.
Yeah. So is that an agenda topic?
It could be, or it could just be. I would say no. We're not trying to do that on the 7th.
Yeah.
But I think in the next 2 months we should call such a meeting, and it can be part of one of these later meetings, maybe the June 20th meeting.
Mm-hmm.
But I just want to get it out there as an idea and get sort of sound people out on it.
Yeah.
Does anybody think that's a terrible idea? Or
no, I think it's a great idea.
Fine.
I don't know if it's a great
idea,
but it's an idea anyway.
Yeah.
I'm going to say it's a pretty good.
It's a pretty good idea.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it's a pretty good idea. I think you ought to give the selectmen, where they got two new members, a little bit of time.
Okay, exactly.
For them to get up to speed too.
Yep.
With the new members.
Exactly.
Yeah.
The
so
new chair.
Yeah, exactly.
With the new chair of the select board and also the two new members.
Yep.
Give them a chance to get their feet under them.
So
well,
maybe
a discussion between you and the chair about
okay.
the timing.
So
right?
maybe I'll reach out to the chair and get some feedback on it. And it could be maybe for June or even July. We don't have to rush that in the next month.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, and in terms of where we could meet, we basically just need space for enough people, right? So we could move these tables in such a way that we could
right.
be here.
Yep.
Or if you know they want something neutral,
we could go there. We could go there.
Right. As long as there's enough room. Yeah.
Yeah.
Neutral.
So
neutral.
We'll
go anywhere.
We will generate one,
okay.
But I think we're going to follow up with the things we talked about early in the meeting, and we want to try to get underway.
Yeah.
You know, we want to be getting a plan for payment. We want to see if we want to form this new committee, and you know, those are.
Samples.
Yeah.
Okay.
Great.
All right.
Okay.
Very good.
Are we adjourned?
Is that it?
Ready for the motion to go into executive session?
Please.
Can we make a note? We've finished an hour meeting, so that's
much more efficient than when I ran the meetings.
No,
it is.
Yeah.
Calling out a good thing for a change.
Are you ready for the motion to go
Please.
Into executive session?
Yes.
Please.
Move that the Board of Commissioners go into executive session to consider the purchase of real estate and return to regular session for the sole purpose of adjournment.
Second.
So
poll the board.
Yeah,
Mr. Pacino,
poll the board.
Tom O'Rourke, aye.
Mr. Stempak, aye.
Yep.
And with that.
All right. Very good.
All right.
Thanks for coming.
Tracy,
good night, gentlemen.
iPad.
Good night,
George.
Sir.
Hey.
Good seeing you again.
Yes.
What's that chart? Did 30 miles?
Wow.
Wow.
No, I'm doing a 100-miler.
She doesn't just do a little race.
Is that like an Ironman race?
Wow. What do you think your pace will be, your mile pace, for a 30-mile?
I'm going to aim
I mean, 100 miles.
5 to 6 miles per hour, hopefully, and then as it goes on, it will get significantly slower.
5 to 6 miles per hour.
About 10-minute mile pace.
About you're gonna aim for 10-minute miles.
Yeah.